Good afternoon. I'm Denise Dinsai, and here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and Vice President Sara Duterte Carpio attend a mass near Malacañang in their first official day in office. Career diplomat Enrique Manalo tapped as Philippine Foreign Affairs Secretary. And former Vice President Leni Robredo launches her Angat Buhay NGO. Welcome to the program. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. attends a mass on his first official day in office. The Thanksgiving Mass was presided by Manila Archbishop Cardinal Jose Advincula and Cardinal Orlando Quevedo at the National Shrine of St. Michael and the Archangels in Manila. Also present were Vice President Sara Duterte and other cabinet members. Marcos was sworn in as the 17th President of the Philippines Thursday at the National Museum in Manila. He is expected to attend the 75th founding anniversary celebration of the Philippine Air Force in Clark, Pampanga this afternoon. President Marcos appoints diplomat Enrique Manalo as the country's new Foreign Affairs Secretary. He replaces Teodoro Locsin Jr. Manalo took his oath before Marcos in Malacañang Friday. He became acting top diplomat in March to May 2017 after Perfecto Yasay failed to get the confirmation as DFA Secretary. He then served as the country's permanent representative to the United Nations in New York from 2020 to 2022. Other key posts in the president's cabinet remain vacant, including the secretaries of health and energy. Chinese President Xi Jinping ready to work with President Marcos. In his congratulatory letter, Xi told Marcos, he's looking towards a continuation of a great chapter of China-Philippine relations. Chinese Vice President Wang Qishan, who represented Xi during Thursday's inauguration, also presented a four-point proposal to enhance bilateral ties. According to Chinese state media, Marcos told Wang, Beijing is Manila's most powerful partner, and that his administration is willing to deepen the country's participation in China's Belt and Road Initiative. There was no mention of China's increased military activities in disputed waters. The Japanese Foreign Minister Yoshimasa Hayashi, who also met with Marcos, said, the Philippine leader agreed to cooperate with Tokyo to maintain and reinforce rules-based maritime order. Albay Representative Joey Salceda says there are enough indicators from President Marcos for Filipinos to be hopeful under his administration. That's despite some critics saying Marcos's campaign lacks solid platforms.
You look at the kind of person that he has already chosen. And anin ba yung mga hiwala pa? Energy, health, at saka foreign affairs. So makikita mo kagad na filled up na yung mga economic departments except for energy. So doon mo kagad makikita ko ano yung kanyang mga priority. Pangalawa, yung pagpili niya bilang secretary siya mismo ng agriculture, you can immediately see his predisposition towards agriculture and essentially food security. I think on the whole, there is enough already guidelines or guidance for Filipinos to be more hopeful under the BBM administration.
Now that another Marcos is in power, a former official of the Presidential Commission on Good Government doubts the PCGG would make further headway in going after the ill-gotten wealth of the family. But Ruben Carranza believes the PCGG will not be abolished by the new president, just repurposed.
There's another reason why the Marcoses might not, in fact, abolish the commission. They want to use it to go after their own cronies to get what they claim is 60% of what these cronies control in businesses and have them returned, not to the Filipino people. Mm-hmm. This is not about recovering ill-gotten wealth but recovering money stolen by the Marcoses, held by Marcos cronies, and now the Marcoses want that money in their pockets.
Former President Rodrigo Duterte, now living his life as a private citizen in his hometown, Davao City. Duterte graced a homecoming concert Thursday night, where he received a warm welcome from his fellow Davaoenos. There, he touted his administration's accomplishments in the fields of education, peace and order, and health care. Duterte said all he wants to do now is catch up on sleep and tour around his home province. His closest aide, Senator Bongo, said Duterte is looking to retire from public service after having served in government since the 80s. Former Philippine Vice President Lenny Robredo back in action a day after stepping down from office. Robredo officially launched her Angat Buhay non-government organization Friday. Angat Buhay was a program she started in 2016 under the office of the Vice President. Robredo says the NGO will focus on health, education, disaster relief and rehabilitation, and community engagement.
Hindi dapat masayang yung magandang nasimulan natin. Hindi man tayo nagtagumpay, hindi man tayo nagbogi, nagtagumpay pa din tayo. Dahil I am sure lahat kayo would agree with us na we really started something very, very special during the campaign. At hindi pwede na mapupunta sa wala yung ating naumpisahan.
The NGO's registration has already been approved by the Securities and Exchange Commission under the corporate name Angat Pinas Incorporated, since there's already a registered Angat Buhay entity. But Robredo says the NGO will still be called Angat Buhay. A House lawmaker wants an extension of a Philippine president's term. Pampanga Representative Aurelio Gonzalez Jr. is proposing a 5-year term with one re-election for the president instead of the current one term of 6 years. The lawmaker also proposed a 5-year term for the vice president with one re-election. Gonzalez also seeks tandem voting for a presidential and vice presidential candidate belonging to the same political party. He cited the majority received by Marcos Duterte tandem in the May 9 elections. Gonzalez filed the same resolution in the last Congress, which failed to act on it. Friends of former Philippine Budget Secretary Rolando Andaya Jr. mourn his passing. Andaya passed away Thursday, but his family did not disclose the cause of death. Andaya lost his bid to become Camarines Sur governor in the May elections. He earlier made headlines when he suggested then Davao City Mayor and now Vice President Sara Duterte could run for president. He later backed the presidential bid of former Vice President Lenny Robredo. Andaya's close friend, House lawmaker Joey Salceda, says his death is a loss for the country.
He was my good friend, and we worked together under President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, essentially handling fiscal matters. So it's truly sad, especially after he also lost his wife, and then, of course, now it's himself. So nakakalungkot kasi he's a stalwart of the national budgeting process.
The number of new COVID cases in the Philippines reaches its highest in over 4 months. The country recorded 1,309 cases Thursday, mostly from Metro Manila. Based on the latest assessment of the Okta Research Group, the positivity rate in 10 areas has increased from June 25 to 29. Okta says in Cavite, the positivity rate edged higher to 13.2%. 6 more areas, including Metro Manila, also breached the World Health Organization's 5% benchmark. Philippine drug regulators urged to include all people with varying medical conditions in the second COVID booster rollout. Under the current rule, the immunocompromised are allowed to take a fourth COVID vaccine shot. But the scope is limited to certain individuals, like those who have immunodeficiency and those living with HIV. Dr. Nina Gloriani, chairperson of the vaccine expert panel, hopes the definition of immunocompromised will be revisited soon.
Dinagdag ay sana makonsider din yung mga maraming comorbidities. May pag-aaral, actually napakagandang pag-aaral yan, isang publication, kung saan tinignan nila yung data nung pag may isa kang sakit, isang comorbidity, nyari may hypertension ka, tapos pangalawa may diabetes ka pa, tapos pangatlo ay nyari meron ka pang mga chronic mga allergies and so on, respiratory disease. Meron silang binibilang 1, 2, 3, may I think merong hanggang may 8 hanggang 10 na may comorbidities. Nakita nila na ang vulnerability ay mas tumataas to COVID, to severe form of COVID, ay mas mataas, mas marami ang iyong mga sakit kasi marami ka rin iniinom na gamot.
COVID-19 cases in Europe also on the rise. The World Health Organization warns the region could see high levels of infections this summer. It cites the lifting of COVID-19 restrictions for the expected increase. COVID cases in Europe have already tripled in the past month, with the region currently registering under 500,000 cases daily. That's up from just around 150,000 at the end of May. The WHO is calling on European countries to keep testing for the virus and increase vaccination rates. It also urges the public to wear masks in crowded places. The World Bank creates a fund to finance investments to strengthen the fight against future pandemics. The World Bank says the fund will support prevention, preparedness and response with a focus on low and middle income countries. It will be used to improve disease surveillance, among others. The fund, which the World Bank hopes to open later this year, has already received over $1 billion in commitments. The U.S. Supreme Court declines to take up a case challenging New York's COVID vaccine mandate for health workers. The High Court rejected the claim of a group of doctors and nurses who argued the mandate violates the Constitution's prohibition against religious discrimination. The court's action follows a decision in December in which the justices declined an emergency request to halt the requirement. Most of the plaintiffs either resigned from their jobs or were fired for refusing to get vaccinated. An update on the weather now. More rains are expected over parts of Luzon as Domeng intensifies into a tropical storm. It was last spotted east of northern Luzon, packing maximum sustained winds of 65 kilometers per hour and gusts of up to 80 kilometers per hour. State Weather Bureau Pagasa says Domeng and another storm outside the Philippines, which was formerly called Caloy, will enhance the southwest monsoon. This could trigger light to moderate rains over central and southern Luzon. Moderate to rough seas are also expected off the northern Philippines, which may be risky for small vessels. Domeng is expected to leave the Philippine area of responsibility on Saturday and intensify into a severe tropical storm. We're taking a quick break. Coming up, the Philippine government's debt slightly declines in May. More on that when we come back. Stay with ANC's Rundown. Welcome back. The Philippine government's debt slightly declines in May. The government's total outstanding debt settled at 12.50 trillion pesos for the month, which is 2.1% lower compared to April. The Bureau of Treasury says the decrease was due to the repayment of provisional advances from the Philippine Central Bank. Domestic debt for the month stood at 8.67 trillion pesos, 3% lower compared to the April level. External debt was at 3.83 trillion pesos. The Philippines borrowed heavily to fund its pandemic response. The country's debt-to-GDP ratio hit 63.5% in March, which is higher than the global standard of 60%. The Philippine Central Bank sees inflation accelerating further in June. The BSP expects the Consumer Price Index to settle within the range of 5.7 to 6.5%. That's way above government's target range of 2 to 4%, and even higher than the 5.4% inflation recorded in May. The BSP cites the continued increase in oil and power prices and the peso's depreciation as primary sources of inflationary pressures for the month. The central bank has raised its benchmark interest rate twice this year to 2.5% in a bid to tame inflation. No more free MRT3 rides for commuters. The government's free train ride program ended on Thursday, June 30, after being extended several times amid rising oil prices. MRT3 General Manager Michael Capatia said the decision on whether to extend the free rides would now be up to the Marcos administration. Meanwhile, the free bus rides at the EDSA bus carousel will continue until July 31st. Public utility vehicle drivers not satisfied with the latest 2 peso fare hike granted by transport regulators. This report from Lady Vicencio.
The 2 peso fare hike for public utility jeepneys will be implemented across the country on July 1st. Base fare will be at 11 pesos in Metro Manila, Region 3 and 4. For modern jeepneys, minimum fare nationwide will be at 13 pesos. But for many jeepney drivers, the fare increase is hardly enough. Public utility drivers argue a meager fare adjustment will not offset the soaring cost of fuel and basic needs.
Yung diesel natin, ma'am, nasa mga 90 plus na, ma'am, eh. Tapos, ma'am, yung pasahero, madalang. Parang wala din nangyari.
Ang provisional increase po na hinihingi nila based on the omnibus motion that they filed last June 23 was a 2 pesos na provisional increase. So,
okay.
Kumbaga, noong June 8, they were already given 1 peso. So, ang dinagdag natin ngayon, 1 peso na lang for NCR, Region 3 and Region 4.
Transport group Piston believes a number of jeepney drivers who changed livelihood because of rising oil prices might return behind the wheel. A commuters group agrees with the fare hike, but more needs to be done to help the transport sector.
Kung sa amin po ay maluwag namin tinatanggap yan, pero dahil po naiintindihan din po namin ang tunay na kalagayan ng drivers, ang inaasahan po namin din ay maging 12 pesos. Dahil nga yung computation niyan, lumalabas po na ang kanilang, ang idinagdag lang natin sa pang-araw-araw na kanilang kita ay 5 liters. Kulang pa rin yung idinagdag natin.
But not all passengers welcome the fare adjustment, saying any increase is an expense they can do without.
Malaking bagay na po. Parehas ko po, eh, tatlong sakay.
Pag kinumpit po yun sa loob ng isang buwan, malaking bagay rin po sa budget po sana namin. Yan ba sa amin po ng mga nagtatrabaho, malaking bagay rin pong pandagdag sa pangkain namin po yun.
Transport regulators have yet to decide on fare hike petitions for taxis, TNVS, and buses, which will now be decided on by the Marcos administration. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
NATO will continue to strike a balance between providing support for Ukraine and preventing a higher level of war. That's according to NATO Chief Jens Stoltenberg on the last day of the alliance's summit in Madrid. He says NATO allies have vowed unprecedented support for Ukraine, including a continuous supply of heavy weaponry.
NATO now has a task to help Ukraine transition from old Soviet era equipment to modern NATO standard equipment. At the same time, we also know that this can get worse, because if this becomes a full-scale war between Russia and NATO, then we'll see suffering, damage, death, destruction at a scale which is much, much worse than what we see in Ukraine today.
Hong Kong swears in its new leader. Chinese President Xi Jinping administered the oath of Hong Kong Chief Executive John Lee Friday morning. Lee was the sole candidate in the elections. He will be replacing Carrie Lam and has promised to usher in a new chapter for Hong Kong. The 64-year-old oversaw the crackdown on the 2019 anti-government protests that roiled the city for months. He was also sanctioned by the U.S. for his role in implementing a national security law that has been used to crack down on dissent. The U.S. Supreme Court deals a blow to the Biden administration's battle against climate change. The High Court ruled government's key environmental agency does not have the power to set sweeping caps on greenhouse gases from coal-fired power plants. President Joe Biden had been hoping to use the Environmental Protection Agency to bring down emissions to meet global climate goals that were set in the 2015 Paris Agreement. Biden called the ruling devastating, but he vowed to take action and find ways to continue protecting Americans. The United Nations, meanwhile, called it a setback in the fight against climate change.
Decisions like today's in the U.S. or any other major emitting economy makes it harder to meet the goals of the Paris Agreement for a healthy, livable planet. This is a setback in our fight against climate change when we're already far off track in meeting the goals of the Paris Agreement. The Secretary General has said repeatedly that the G20 must lead the way in dramatically stepping up climate action.
Judges from Kentucky and Florida blocked the states from enforcing bans or restrictions on abortion. This comes after the U.S. Supreme Court's move to overturn the Roe v. Wade decision that gave states the authority to deny, limit, or allow abortions. In Florida, a judge approved a petition from abortion rights groups to temporarily put on hold a state law that would bar abortions after the 15th week of pregnancy. A Kentucky judge, meanwhile, issued a temporary restraining order preventing the state from enforcing a ban triggered by the Supreme Court's ruling. U.S. Supreme Court Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson has been sworn in, making history as the first female African American to hold the post. In a statement following her oath-taking, Jackson said she will support and defend the U.S. Constitution and administer justice without fear or favor. But she is joining a court in turmoil. The U.S. is still reeling from the aftermath of the court's most consequential rulings in decades, the overturning of abortion rights, the expansion of gun rights, and now limiting government's power to curb carbon emissions. In entertainment, Natalie Portman celebrates female strength as she stars in Thor: Love and Thunder. Yong Chavez tells us more about some of the characters in the latest Marvel film to hit the big screen.
A as an actress, Oscar winner Natalie Portman relishes the chance to transform and play various characters. For Thor: Love and Thunder, her physical preparations began months before the cameras rolled so she could return to the Marvel film franchise as Jane Foster, now also known as the Mighty Thor.
It's so exciting to get to play a character like Jane. I feel so lucky to get to be, get to be a superhero. That's like such an extraordinary opportunity, and I feel so lucky to have had the chance. And Jane is also such an incredible character as an astrophysicist. I feel like that's exciting to get to represent to girls.
Her co-star Tessa Thompson celebrated Portman's and the Thor's cast's return on the big screen. Thompson also shared what it meant for her to be part of a big Hollywood film.
Natalie rejoining us. She's a good friend of mine, so having her felt like summer camp. The last time around, they were a little more freewheeling. This time, they're like, Thor is having a midlife crisis. Valkyrie has finally turned herself around and is a woman of bureaucracy and responsibility. And so it's fun to play these characters that we love so much and see them grow as we grow too. I grew up in Los Angeles. I used to come to movies here. My dad would take me to this cinema, and it was always like a big deal when I got to see movies here. So I can't believe I am now in movies here.
The film recently held its star-studded world premiere in Hollywood, led by Thor himself, Chris Hemsworth. The latest Marvel movie also stars film actor Dave Bautista, who appears as his Guardians of the Galaxy character, Drax.
Thor: Love and Thunder is directed by Taika Waititi, who also returns in the movie as Korg. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
And that's the rundown. I'm Denise Dinsai. Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.